there, my name is Ibreez Ajaz. I work as an internal medicine trainee in the United Kingdom. And as you've just heard from our earlier lesson by Ibrahim, discussing postgraduate training versus postgraduate degree, what I want to talk about in the next part of our course is essentially about the roles of different organizations. So when you start out as a trainee in the NHS, you'll hear a lot of names being thrown around, stuff like GMC or General Medical Council or the Royal Colleges or LETB or Deaneries, and it can be very confusing to really understand what their roles are and how they affect you in your day-to-day. So if we first start talking about the General Medical Council or GMC, GMC is the Medical Regulatory Board in the United Kingdom. It's through them that you get your license, and it's through them that all the training curriculum is set up. This training curriculum is, of course, then matched with what each individual Royal College wants for their specific trainees. For instance, if you are in, you know, the Royal College of Physicians, so somebody who will enter into medical training, there is certain competencies or certain tasks that they will want you to be able to accomplish throughout your training. As an internal medicine trainee, in my competencies of my portfolio, there are certain tasks that I need to be able to do and certain things I need to show that I'm able to do. For instance, things like breaking bad news or being able to do an NG tube insertion or a lumbar puncture. And these all will compile together in my portfolio, which I will then show that I am competent and able to do these types of tasks. So these are things that have been set down by the Royal College for things that I need to complete throughout my 3 years of internal medicine training. Further on from these Royal Colleges, when you specifically get into specialty-specific types of training, you will be known to the names of certain societies. For instance, the British Society of Geriatrics or the British Society of Gastroenterology, they too will have set down certain guidances and guidelines of things that they would want you to accomplish within that training that is then, of course, compliant with what the General Medical Council wants out of you. All right? Now, after that, the thing that I had mentioned before was the Local Education and Training Board, or LETB. So this name is pretty much interchangeable with deaneries. What that means is, when you think about the United Kingdom as a whole, the United Kingdom itself is made up of England, Wales, Scotland, and Northern Ireland. Now, within each of these parts, there are separate divisions made so that each area is then, you know, responsible for a certain amount of trainees. For instance, I, as an internal medicine trainee in Plymouth, fall under the Southwest Peninsula Deanery. So if I have any issues or if there's anything that needs to be told to me about my training, it's someone from the Peninsula Deanery who contacts me. It's the same thing throughout other parts of England and the United Kingdom. You know, it could be east of England, you could be West Midlands, you could be the Northeast. All of these places have their specific deaneries that you then contact. If you ever have any issues regarding anything, the first point of contact would be your deanery, and it's through them that the recruitment occurs. When you are eventually selected for a training post, it's the deanery that reaches out to you and tells you, well, here's your certificate of sponsorship if you need one. Here's the stuff that you need to understand how to progress and finish all the documentation required to enter into your training program. All right, I hope that makes sense. Now, we've talked about what? We've talked about GMC, we've talked about the Royal Colleges, we've talked about societies, we've talked about deaneries. But really, all of this would mean nothing if we wouldn't talk about the first and foremost important thing, and that would be the National Health Service, or the NHS. So the NHS is, like I said, the National Health Service. It's pretty self-explanatory, but it is within this major organization, if we think of it as an organogram, that we are trickling down the GMC, then the Royal Colleges, the deaneries, and then you as a trainee. You are all part of this major infrastructure known as the NHS. And the role that you play in the NHS is then, of course, mandated and regulated by the earlier bodies that we've mentioned. Anything and everything that you do when you work within the NHS is as part of the public health service that is offered in the United Kingdom. As a trainee, what you need to be aware of is you are within the NHS, you are within these organizations, and it is these organizations that you can turn to if you need any help or anything else further explained to you. Just to clarify, there are private hospitals, and at any time in your career, you can choose to work in a private hospital, but if you are intending to progress your career in a training situation, in a training program, you need to go through the NHS or the public healthcare system, okay? So I hope my explanation of the roles of different organizations in the NHS made sense and how you as a trainee play a role in all of this and who you can then, you know, expect to hear from and who you can expect to turn to throughout your training progression in the United Kingdom. So I hope this part of the course made sense to you all, and we'll move on to our next lesson, which is going to discuss about the doctor's training structure in the United Kingdom.